Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Richard Kuhl. I'm the program head for the Masters of Arts program in Environmental Education here at Royal Roads University, and love to welcome you here to the Center for Dialogue and the Learning and Innovation Center. This is the 11th annual Robert Bateman Lecture. In 2005, when our first cohort was getting ready to graduate, we invited Robert and Birgit Bateman to come to the Royal Roads and for Robert to talk to us about the things he was interested in. We had a wonderful evening. In fact, Bateman had a wonderful day here. He fell in love with this place. He had never been here before. He loved the mixture of this beautiful natural environment with this really very rich cultural environment, both First Nations and colonial environments here, and he really loved the place and has become very involved with Royal Roads. And so we named the lecture series that we were giving every year for the at the end of our residency in his honor. I'd like to thank the Royal Roads University Foundation for helping sponsor this. And I'd also like to thank the Dogwood Initiative for really getting the word out to its membership and others in the community. And they've got a table out here with information about Dogwood, and I'd encourage you to take a look at it later. The 11th Bateman Lecture is really congruent with all the others that we've had. We've brought in innovative, provocative, and interesting communicators and educators, almost entirely from Southern Vancouver Island or the region, to talk to us about the things that are important to the program that I run, the program in environmental education and communication. And our speaker tonight, Franke James, really fits into this rubric really well. Before we get to Franke, though, I'd first like to introduce Beverly DeVries, who's one of the students in our MA program, who's been the recipient of the Robert and Birgit Bateman bursary. We try to raise money every year to fund this bursary to help graduate students in our program, and if any of you would like to help with that fundraising and contribute potentially, we do have information for you and ways you can contact the university about that donation. But I'd like to first introduce Beverly.
Thank you. I'll be brief. I want to thank the Batemans for their kindness and generosity. Aside from the financial help, this bursary was like a vote of confidence, a little bit like a water station and cheerleaders at the middle mark of a marathon. So I'm deeply honored and forever grateful to have been a recipient. Thank you. I'm looking forward to this talk.
Thanks, Beverly. And now I'd like to introduce one of our students, Richard Littlemore. He will introduce the speaker tonight.
Hi, good evening. Thank you. It's my pleasure to do this, actually. I was speaking at the U of T with George Momio. It was my finest hour. And Franke came rushing to the stage afterwards to introduce herself and gave me a copy of of her book, My Green Conscience. And at the time, I was kind of gapping on it. And I didn't read it for actually some time afterwards, but it pretty much saved me in Copenhagen. We then ran into one another again. I've got a list of Frankie's awards, which I'm frankly not going to read. Frankly, sorry. because it's too long, and because it's so long that she's even left stuff off, including the award that she won at the San Francisco Green Book Festival in 2010, where we met, again. And we just got along pretty fabulously from the outset and started chatting back and forth. I was editing the DSmog blog at the time. And I was there at my desk one day working on climate change denial, and Franke phoned in a real sweat. She had been booked for a tour of Europe to do a tour of art shows across Europe, and that had come to a sudden and unfortunate halt because it seemed the government of Canada pulled some of the funding that they were responsible for and intervened in a way to discourage the host from even allowing the tour to continue. And so Franke was rightfully disappointed and increasingly concerned because she found out that part of the reason that the tour had been killed was because the Prime Minister, somebody in the Prime Minister's office, had intervened to kill it. And I said, Franke, that's great. journalist, right? Like if you've attracted the attention of power, you're doing your job. And Frankie said, you know, it doesn't feel great. But we sort of worked that through. And I said, the Prime Minister will not swat a pest if the pest has not drawn blood. So clearly, if Stephen Harper is afraid of you, then you're doing good work. And you should be proud and everything's... So this went on for a while, and Frankie started doing, Frankie and her husband Bill started doing freedom of information requests to find more information out, to find more about how this whole thing had come to crash and burn. And as she got more information, she found more and more material that did actually implicate the Prime Minister's office. And it was again upsetting. Frankie's back on the phone. And she's trying to be worried about this again, and I'm just excited, because clearly this is all working really well. And she called and said she just doesn't understand why she would be this kind of a target. And I said, you to the Prime Minister are like one of those East African cockroaches, the ones that are so big that when you hit them with your shoe, they get up and walk away. You know. And Frankie said, You're calling me a cockroach? and I said no. Because this is the image of her of Frankie that always sticks in my mind of the bothered by my green conscience. I called her naive and incurably optimistic, and she's never quite forgiven me for that. I shouldn't have repeated it. But this is not the image of somebody who you would have thought the Prime Minister would be afraid of. Anyway, I had to work slowly through the cockroach thing, but I was delighted when the next time I saw a piece of her work, I saw this. So she's really getting it. Like. So this is the image of Frankie we know and you will come to love. That up there is the image of Frankie that is held in the Prime Minister's heart. I'm thrilled to have her. I think anybody who cares about democracy, about openness, responsibility, transparency in government, who cares about democracy, who cares about civil liberties and just fairness, should be delighted to have Frankie in the fight. And we all should be delighted to have her in the room. I give you Frankie James.
So thanks to all of you for coming tonight. Thanks to Royal Roads and Rick Cool for inviting me. And thank you to Richard for that wonderful introduction. And it was so wonderful to be able to reach out to Richard and ask his advice. Like, what do I do now? Oh my God, you know, why is he targeting me? What's happened? So anyway, I thought that the format for tonight is I'm going to read you three stories and I'm going to give a little bit of perspective on how I fought back. And I hope that you find it inspiring. I think that right now is a really, really, really important time that we're in because the federal election is right around the corner, October 19th. And how many people in this room are going to vote? Yes! And how many people in this room have ever been silenced or asked not to talk about something by the government, by relatives, by friends, by family? Has anyone in this room ever been? Okay, so almost everyone has experienced it. And I was really shocked when it happened to me. So I'm going to tell you the story of Band on the Hill. We're going to start with that. I didn't make his fishing buddies list, but I did make his please donate money list. Despite me screaming, "Ack, please put me on your do not call list." But making Harper's blacklist is something I never dreamed of. Who would have thought I could get into so much trouble by writing a letter to my dear Prime Minister asking him to make polluters pay. So this is a double-page spread from my letter in 2008, which coincidentally was also before an election. You say the other parties are dangerous because they will tax polluters. But if we don't tax polluters, who will pay to clean up the mess? Really simple questions that are really hard for politicians to answer. Will my children and yours be paying? I never thought it would get me into such a pickle. As you can see, I have a lot of fun with visual images. Because I was always taught to speak up, growing up in a family of seven kids. And the funny thing is, if an educational nonprofit in Croatia hadn't asked to buy my art for a touring show in Europe, wow, my big dream, a solo show to inspire students to make their own climate change art. And here were the 20 cities that it was supposed to go to: Copenhagen, Vienna, Zagreb, Athens, Tel Aviv, Cairo, all over the place. But all that changed one fine day in May when the NGO called me about a delicate matter. I don't want to step on anyone's toes, Sandra said. Sandra got a call from the cultural officer at the Canadian Embassy in Croatia. Meet me at the coffee shop, the official whispered. This is off the record. Don't you know this artist speaks against the Canadian government? Oh my goodness, why would she say that? I said. Oh, Ottawa is very unhappy with your visual essay to the Prime Minister. And this is another spread from that visual letter to the Prime Minister in 2008, highlighting the fact that the tar sands is Canada's largest and fastest growing source of greenhouse gas. Or at least it was until they changed the way that they calculate emissions. And now you can only say that it's the largest or the fastest growing source of greenhouse gas emissions because they calculate it differently. Anyway, will our kids be angry that Alberta was ravaged? Word is that when a top official in Ottawa heard, he said, who's the idiot who approved of an art show by that woman, Franke James? And this is really what I was told by Sandra. She's telling me this. And I'm going, what? It's like, this doesn't make any sense. Which really took me aback. I didn't know the government knew who I was, let alone hated me. And Richard's cockroach made it into the... Incredibly, I am blacklisted. And I'm in very, very good company. Look at that list of people on the flag. Everybody from Richard Colvin to Linda Keane and Errol Mendes and many, many others. Anyway, I am being blacklisted for disagreeing with my leader's grand vision for Canada to become an energy superpower and use the sky as a sewer. Fast forward 2.5 months, and my once-in-a-lifetime European tour got canned. In the press, the government denied any interference. Funding was never withdrawn, nor was it guaranteed. Allegations of a political conspiracy against Ms. James are a fantasy of her own making. There was no political interference in this decision. And when the government says that in the press, it's like, you are nothing. You are just this tiny little flea. You mean nothing. It doesn't matter what you say. But actually, the government did approve my show. And so this is one of the access to information documents that I got. And we can see that the Planning, Advocacy, and Innovation Office approved it and said, and they've got the weirdest acronyms, GLB is able to give $5,000 on our advocacy funds budget for your mission. So they weren't giving the money to me, they were giving it to the NGO, Nectarina, as part of the UNFCCC agreement for climate change, where Canada is supposed to help to put money into the pot to help educate about climate change. So the government did approve my show, and then the climate office killed it. I didn't know that the Department of Foreign Affairs had a climate office. And this is how I found out. It was actually the deputy director of climate change who pulled the trigger and killed the show. Now you can see the gray part is blacked out. So if I read just the sentence before that. It says, we have advised him that MDC, which is their acronym for the Climate Change Office, would not recommend funding for this project. And then it's blacked out. And it's blacked out under Section 15.1, which is a really high-level security redaction for international security and the defense of Canada. It's like, what could be under there? What could be under there? So this is 2011. Okay, spring 2015. So this isn't in my book. This is just new that I got this. And the part that's highlighted is the part that was formerly redacted. So we can, if I read that sentence again, we have advised him that the Climate Change Office would not recommend funding for this project, especially in light of the current context and the extremely sensitive nature of the climate change issue. And to get that little sentence unredacted, it was like fighting tooth and nail. It took 4 years. Office of the Information Commissioner had to do an investigation and challenge the government on the legitimacy of their redactions. And so they looked at it and they went, guys, listen, okay, this is not security in the defense of Canada. It's a little embarrassing for you, you know, and it shows that Franke James was right, that she was being silenced because of the climate change issue. And the part where he says, in light of the current context was the fact that in 2011, Europe was deciding whether or not to slap a dirty oil label on Alberta oil. And so they, like my art show just was coming at a very inconvenient time for them. And they just thought that they would put it, you know, they'd make sure that it never happened by telling people not to show my art. And they also thought that I would never hear about it. But it wasn't the government funding that was withdrawn. It would only have paid for a few postage stamps. The thing that killed the show was the government putting a black mark on me, which created a ripple effect, scaring away venues and sponsors. And finally, even the NGO, who couldn't stand to be in the crossfires of Canadian politics. The NGO called it a Don Quixote fight, particularly as the exhibitions had been canceled. And I had gone to the various embassies and asked if I could rent space at my own expense to have an event, not the art show, but just like a party, a press conference, something. And initially they said, yes, we'd love to, you know, help support a Canadian artist. Then they heard it was me and that Ottawa didn't want to support my show in any way. So they wouldn't even let me rent space. So that's why I say in this screen, I thought the Canadian embassies were there to help all Canadians. And they wouldn't even give me a handshake, which is very un-Canadian. How can I fight back against the Harper government? It's huge and powerful and rolling in oil money. Yes. And I'm only one person. But this is so wrong. The government should not be warning people not to exhibit my art. I may be small, but I need to speak up. I need to shine a bright light on this dark deed. And I'm not going to give up, because Canada is still a free country. So I turned to Twitter, and social media is just amazing. Twitter was so helpful, and I used the hashtag free speech, and lots of people came forward and tweeted and supported. And this lady, Catherine Wellner, who's from BC, started a petition on Care 2. And end Canada's attempt to silence artists, blacklisted Canadian artists becoming mosquito in government's ears. And she was great. And almost 5,000 people wrote to, signed the petition that went to Harper as a result of that. So that was 2011. And then The Star did sort of an expose article at the end of July in 2011, and they interviewed Sandra Antonovic, who was the NGO from Croatia. They're the only newspaper to have successfully interviewed her, because once that story hit the, hit the papers, and she got so much flack in Croatia, she would not speak up anymore, and she subsequently lost her job. And interestingly, the Ottawa Citizen wrote this article, "Government Officials Killed Funding for Canadian Artist, Documents Show." So at the same time that I submitted my access to information requests, Amy Chung at Post Media News submitted access to information requests. And that was so neat because she's the one who had written a very critical article where she quoted the government spokesperson saying that it was all a fantasy. So, and I was furious. But anyway, she she actually decided that she was going to dig for the truth. So just like me, she applied for access to information, and she was then able to write this this article. And a few months ago, Toronto artist Franke James said political bullying by the federal government had caused her European art tour to fall apart. Claims the conservative government quickly and firmly rebuked. But newly released documents obtained under access to information legislation show, and then she goes on to explain how they were not telling the truth. So we got lots and lots of media, and that was great. And lots of action on social media. And were they helping me because I'm an artist and I'm Franke James? No, they were helping me because they care about free speech, because they care about unethical oil and transparency and democracy and pollution and all of these reasons. And that's why Twitter and Facebook are so powerful. But then I asked for advice from a friend in San Francisco, and he said, call Colin. And he was the perfect guy to talk to because Colin had done billboards like this one for 350.org. What if our billboards inspired us toward a future we actually wanted? And Colin said, hey, wouldn't it be funny to put your art in Ottawa, like right where the Prime Minister can see it? And I went, wow, yeah, that'd be so funny. Yeah, let's do it. Oh my God, we've got to do this. And so I started a crowdfunding campaign. And this is one of the tweets of support. And raised $4,226 from 82 people that helped me to put posters up in Ottawa in November 2011. And this is one of the posters. And that's what it looked like on the street. The Harper government instituted a new communications policy in 2007 at Environment Canada. And they said that just as we have one department, one website, we should have one department, one voice. So they clamped down on the scientists and said they could not speak to the media without going through their one voice department. And the upshot of that, media coverage of climate change science, our most high-profile issue, has been reduced by over 80%, and it's only gotten worse since then. So Harper can muzzle government scientists, but controlling the message from individual citizens, artists like me, isn't so easy, especially with social media. That's why governments around the world are afraid of artists and social media, because our voices joined together have the power to change governments. If Harper knew the Canadians wanted him to change from this, Canada is a dirty old man, that's what the Guardian said, to this, Canada is a leader in clean, green energy. I must admit, he does look a little scary. And that it would be the source of his sustainable power. Well, Harper could turn green overnight. And he would ponder the cruel irony that fossil fuels may cause the extinction of mankind. He would stop loafing and get to work on reducing CO2. But that won't happen unless we exercise our power. Write your own Dear Prime Minister letter. Tell him why going green is the only sane thing for Canada. Tell him why it will be good for his children. Tell him why it will help him hold on to power, and why history will look kindly on him as a leader. Canada was the colossal fossil before Harper saw the error of his foolish ways and repented. and how our great leader restored our reputation as a cold country where polar bears roam and where even folks from Toronto can play hockey outdoors on real ice, and everyone is nice and very polite. And we never tell people to shut up, because that's just not Canadian. So these are some outtakes. Thank you. So this is so funny. It really felt like a Hollywood movie. I mean, we wondered if there was some fix in, because I got the access to information documents, the first bunch of them that showed that the government had lied about the funding. And I got it 2 days before the show opened in Ottawa in November 2011. And it was very spooky. Right near, we got them on Halloween, so very spooky, yes. So we got lots of media attention. And the posters really got a lot of press, and it was a very effective way to raise awareness of the message that I wanted to raise. So now I'm going to start the second story, What is Harper Afraid Of? And it's kind of funny that I could write this story, because at the time I was living in Toronto, and I didn't have a connection with BC, except that I was following the news and I was concerned about the Northern Gateway Pipeline. And my mother had been born in Vancouver. But the thing was, I had a very important connection to the Northern Gateway Pipeline, and you'll see in this story. Hey, Mr. Prime Minister, what are you afraid of? Are you afraid of rivers that turn black and run into the sea? Are you afraid of birds falling from the sky? Are you afraid of people fleeing from a toxic land? Or maybe you are most afraid of this, Alberta tar sands oil being labeled dirty. I can tell you what I'm afraid of. I'm afraid of your plans to build the Northern Gateway Pipeline through the Rocky Mountains and the Great Bear Rainforest. Does that make me a radical? No way. But Joe Oliver, your Minister of Natural Resources, says anyone who questions the pipeline is a radical. Does everyone remember the news story when Joe Oliver said that, called environmentalists radicals? Well, the funny thing is that Joe was my MP at that time. And so I sent him a Valentine, and I made requests to him on social media and in email, requesting that I have a meeting with him, because I was an environmentalist and I was a constituent of his. And it was a little bit of touch and go, but he did agree to the interview. And I was kind of surprised, because I'd already done this, you know, blacklisting show in 2011. And I sent Joe a Valentine asking for a meeting. On March 3rd, my husband and I met with Joe, and I had a tape recorder with me. And they had been very reluctant to let me bring a tape recorder in, but I was very insistent and said, you know, I'm writing a book, I have to be accurate, I need to bring in the tape recorder. And back and forth, I got to bring the tape recorder in. So actually, if you see this video on online, you can hear Joe Oliver's voice. I asked Joe a fundamental question: what bothers your green conscience? But Joe said, I don't think in those terms. My impact as the Minister of Natural Resources is much bigger than as an individual, which is exactly what I'm afraid of. With all the changes you're making, gutting the Fisheries Act, trashing the Environmental Assessment Act, overruling the National Energy Board, well, I can't even read them all. There are just so many. Silencing the scientists, lifting the 40-year ban on tankers on BC's coast, we could be hit with some major environmental catastrophes. It's like you've declared war on Mother Nature. Joe told me, I'm someone who likes to gather the facts. I'm influenced by what objective scientists say. And you know, government policy has to be grounded in facts, which all sounds great. But then why is the Harper government muzzling scientists? And we can look back at these headlines from before 2008. Here's one: Harper government muzzling environment Canadian kin to scientists. Joe says he likes facts, so I shared some, like how the BC coast has had a 40-year ban on tankers because the waters are so treacherous. and how the tankers are as long as the Empire State Building is tall, 1,250 feet, and how the route to Kitimat is very skinny with many hairpin turns, which are tricky for big tankers. So at the time that I'm telling my story, I'm trying to educate people in a fun way about the basics of why it doesn't make sense to put the pipeline through the Great Bear Rainforest. And Joe replied, "I don't know the answers to that question. I'm not a scientist. So that's why we're getting an independent evaluation." The independent evaluation sounded good, but since then you've squashed their power, and now Joe and your cabinet are making the final decision. And quite a few of those names have changed in the cabinet since I did that story in 2012. But Joe is obviously not qualified to decide. This can't be right. This doesn't make any sense at all. It isn't transparent. Everything you discuss in cabinet is secret. Even access to information requests can't reveal cabinet confidences. I can understand why you want the pipeline. Alberta and Big Oil will be making trillions, but British Columbia will be facing huge risks. One big spill would wipe out BC's entire tax revenue of $1.2 billion, and that's forecast over 30 years. And the nice notankers.ca dollar featured right there. I've got this sinking feeling about Enbridge. Just look at the 1989 Exxon Valdez spill. Even though Exxon spent more than $3.4 billion, the true costs were estimated to be $9.5 billion. Ultimately, US citizens ended up paying the additional costs. And that's what Canadian citizens face if there's a big spill. And some accidents never get cleaned up. The Queen of the North that sank in 2006 is still leaking fuel. But the real truth is money can't bring the birds, fish, and whales back to life, or the spirit bear who depends on the salmon. There's a whole circle of life. So I asked Joe a very simple question. Would you let your family eat the fish or drink the water from the Athabasca River? And here's what he said. "I don't know enough about the Athabasca River. I would want to know from the government whether it's safe." How can Joe not know about the Athabasca? It's beside the tar sands. Shouldn't the minister of the tar sands mining know if the tar sands are polluting the air, land, or water? Take a look at this Environment Canada report on oil sands pollution, which I just happened to have with me that day. It's labeled secret. When I showed it to Joe, he said, "It's secret to me too." Well, I don't know if it came before I was appointed, May 18th, but in any case, it's not my ministry. It's been out in the news for a while. Yeah, I've heard something. So I've got Joe riding a fish, and it's superimposed on top of a Toronto Star article, "Deformed fish found in lake downstream from the oil sands," and that was from 2010, so 2 years earlier. Dr. Schindler from the University of Alberta, I called him up, I interviewed him, and he told me he would not drink the Athabasca water near the tar sands. And right in this Environment Canada secret report, I mean, this just makes me so mad. I'm reading it, I'm going, "Contamination of the Athabasca River is a high profile concern. Recent studies suggest elevated levels of pollutants near mining sites, including hydrocarbons and heavy metals, raises questions about possible effects on health of wildlife and downstream communities." I mean, it's right there, they know it. So I say, "Mr. Prime Minister, this is a big problem. And this secret report shows that Environment Canada knows it's a big problem." Just recently, the BBC reported that the Cree Lake Nation are taking fish out of the water that have cancerous tumors. It seems that the government has been hiding from the truth. So this is really interesting. In 2010, federal politicians mysteriously canceled an 18-month investigation into oil sands pollution in water and destroyed draft copies of their final report. I mean, how can this be right and fair? This is terrible. The fact is, you've got people eating contaminated fish, and that's wrong. It really boils down to environmental racism. It's irresponsible resource development, as opposed to their slogan at the time, which was responsible resource development. First Nations had filed a complaint with the United Nations that Harper government racism on pipelines violates international law. And even if you don't have a humanitarian bone in your body, you've got to know that taxpayers and investors are exposed to class action lawsuits. Most Canadians think that the tar sands are an important resource, but few would accept that people being poisoned from tar sands mining is just the cost of doing business. How many times have you heard other, you know, friends, other Canadians say, but you know what, you know, it's just like Canada depends on the oil sands, right? And we have to develop them. So this is not right. Mr. Harper, I know that you're what you're really afraid of. You're afraid of dead ducks, because a dead ducks campaign against dirty tar sands oil could scare away foreign investors. You're afraid of spirit bears, because they inspire everyone to care about Canada's wilderness and say no to the pipeline. You're afraid of killer whales, because First Nations are asserting their rights to protect their land, water, and way of life. And they are really doing a huge job in protecting Canada. But you're most afraid of beavers. That's us hardworking Canadians who are toiling away like busy beavers, because we are waking up, talking to one another, and agreeing on the message you need to hear. Please, Mr. Harper, don't put the pipeline through the Great Bear Rainforest. Please, Mr. Harper, I'm very polite, stop polluting our pond. It's the only one we have. Make Harper really afraid. Call your MP and complain. And over 8,000 people signed the petition and sent that story to Ottawa, which is fantastic. And they sent it to their local MPs as well. And the reason that I was able to get 8,000 people to send that letter is in large part thanks to Dogwood, because Dogwood shared it with their membership list, and it just went like wildfire. It's amazing. Okay, so are people ready for one more story? Okay, so this one is pretty funny. Franke James is your fault. I was shocked to discover Thomas Marr's email rant with this undiplomatic subject line, Franke James is your fault. Suddenly, I was a scandal. And so there it is, right up there. Look at that. The yellow subject line, it says, Franke James is your fault, and all that stuff that's blacked out. And you know, even though the Office of the Information Commissioner did a great job investigating and getting some redactions removed just recently, they were not able to get any of the redactions removed from this letter. And this letter is redacted under Section 15.1, International Security and the Defense of Canada, and for personal reasons, 19.1, and 21A and B, which have to do with discussions with the minister or about government policy. So, Franke James is your fault. I was thinking of different covers for my new book that was coming out. And I wondered, who is Thomas Marr? So I started Googling. Thomas Marr is a trade commissioner at the Canadian Embassy in Berlin. He used to be the ambassador to Croatia, and that was his link. And just to confirm that he really was, and that I hadn't made a mistake, I actually emailed him. And he replied and confirmed that he did used to be the ambassador to Croatia, which is how he knew Vlatka at the Canadian Embassy. Marr wrote to Vlatka asking if I was her fault. He wrote, Nectarine, a nonprofit, is a Croatian organization, and you have connected them with Ms. James, who has a green conscience? Do I look like a green-headed monster? There must have been a big stink on the hill, and we don't know. And so this was an email from the ambassador to the Baltic States, Scott Hetherington. And this indicates some of the background chatter that was going on. And this one, Scott Hetherington says that he did not feel comfortable supporting my show, and then it's blacked out. But his next line is, please see Franke James' site, and he's got a typo, Fat Cat Canada's Giant Litter Box, which is my essay that I wrote in 2009, and it's about the tar sands, and it's very critical. And just recently, 2015, we found out what was under. So I'm going to flip back. See that black? Okay, so now, this is what was unredacted by the Office of the Information Commissioner. We did not feel comfortable supporting this particular initiative due to controversial views on energy issues, particularly oil sands. So my request to rent some space at the embassy was not allowed because of my political views on the oil sands. And to me, that's pretty undemocratic. That's really terrible. Should I use Mars' scandalous email as my book title? I tried some cover concepts. Nah, too scary. But the heavily blacked out email spoke volumes. I decided this would be the best cover, and I have my kind of Alice hiding underneath the redactions. I sent it to a few friends to hear their thoughts. Most gave it a thumbs up. But some were dubious. People won't get it unless they hear the backstory. That would be a shame. I want people to hear how free expression is being squashed to serve the oil industry's agenda. So I'm thinking of all those Tim Hortons coffee drinkers out there. So I sent an email to Elizabeth May, MP and leader of the Green Party. What do you think of the title? Is it great? She shot back, I'd go even more radical. Bound and gagged. Why Stephen Harper banned Franke James. Classic Elizabeth. You know, and I thought, well, you know, it is a powerful title, but it sounds a little S&M. There was nothing kinky, just creepy secret interference by Canadian bureaucrats. Which is really shocking. The official secretly warned Nectarina not to exhibit my art because my art show was to inspire students to make art about climate change. And this was like one of the pieces that was supposed to be in the show. If people can be convinced to pick up dog shit, who knows what social change is possible? I mean, really, in society, we've had some amazing changes. You know, like 30 years ago, recycling wasn't big. Most of us were just putting our stuff into a single trash can. And now, 30 years later, you know, everybody's recycling. And back in 1978, 79, the pooper scooper law came in, and now lots of people are picking up after their dogs. So social change is possible. We just have to have the right carrots and the right sticks. The government secretly interfered and the show was canceled. Internally, they said, the artist's work dealt mostly with climate change and was advocating a message that was contrary to the government's policies on the subject. So that quote was an internal quote that they never thought that I would see. And when I saw it, I went, wow, that's amazing. They're telling me, do not talk about climate change. And they're telling me that I can't get, you know, any support from them. And I think if art has to agree with government policies, then art equals government propaganda. I sent Harper this message in November 2011 to please stop punishing our environmental voices. But he didn't listen. Since then, things have gotten worse. Scientists are protesting being muzzled and that evidence is being buried. This was a spectacular, spectacular protest. It was so well done. And they used so much symbolism, the Grim Reaper, the coffin, the lab coats. It was just perfect. If the evidence is hidden, how can we make informed decisions? Indigenous peoples are protesting. And I ask, oh, Canada, what's going down? Even librarians are being silenced. There's a chilling code of conduct at Library and Archives Canada. And they were protesting interference with freedom of expression. They weren't even allowed to teach or speak at conferences, and that was indicated as high-risk activities. So I look back at George Orwell, and this makes a lot of sense. Political language is designed to make lies sound truthful and murder respectable, and to give an appearance of solidity to pure wind. George Orwell, 1946. And David Schindler really says it well. Believing in clean oil sands is like believing in magic fairies. Why are people allowed to lie to the public like this? I just don't understand it. We have to challenge them. Obviously, the people who used to challenge them, the civil servants, are no longer allowed to. So I call it Orwellian Ottawa, where dirty oil is clean, nature is bad, lies are truth. Even citizens are being gagged with red tape to prevent them from speaking up at pipeline hearings. More artists are facing censorship threats for opposing big oil. And Brian Falconer with Raincoast Conservation, he was part of this, he was speaking to the news media about art for an oil-free coast, and Calgary City Hall was threatening to shut it down. And do you know who was in that show? Robert Bateman. So, you know, Robert Bateman, you know, has experienced censorship on this issue too. That's pretty fascinating. I told Harper one thing, you're infringing on my right to freedom of expression. And the government said, I don't believe it is our responsibility to address the charter claims Ms. James is making. And this is right from access to information documents. They don't give a damn. So that's when I decided I've got to do this poster. Do not talk about climate change. It is against Canada's policy. And take that internal quote and put it on posters. The artist's work dealt mostly with climate change and was advocating a message that was contrary to the government's policies on the subject. So who is responsible for protecting our charter rights if the Canadian bureaucrats don't even care? Who is responsible for protecting our charter rights and our land from sea to shining sea? Isn't it time we asked each other, is Stephen Harper your fault? Let's admit our mistakes in book titles and prime ministers and move on. Tell Harper we've had our fill. We will not be banned on the Hill. Canada belongs to all of us. So I've got another little section, if people are up for it, and that's on fighting for the right to speak up. Is it okay to go on? Okay, all right. Thank you. So this was such a challenge. Okay, so I'd done the access to information. I'd done the show in 2011, okay? But I still didn't have justice, right? And so how was I really going to really make this stick? Well, I had to write a book. So I wrote the book, Banned on the Hill, which has got the whole sort of sequence from 2008, writing to the Prime Minister, through to discovering that I was blacklisted with Banned on the Hill, through to the Franke James is your fault. And when it first came out, The Guardian UK wrote a great story. And the headline was just beautiful. Artist finds inspiration in Canadian government's attempt to silence her. Now, imagine you are Stephen Harper or Ottawa, and you're reading that, and you go, what? She's inspired? She's not supposed to be inspired, right? But the interesting thing is that this is a direct message I got when I let a friend at a Canadian NGO know about the article from The Guardian, okay? So I direct messaged him and I said, got this great article that just came out in The Guardian. And he said, thanks, I can't share the news because it could jeopardize our charitable status, but I wish you the best. And that is really, really represents the culture of fear. Here I was speaking up, and in that way it's good because I'm an individual, I'm not a government worker, I don't work for anybody, they can't fire my boss, right? And I'm independent, so it's good. I have a role to play as an independent voice. But the Canadian NGO, really, they are just hamstrung. They are keeping their mouths shut because they are so afraid that they're going to lose their charitable status. And that is a tragedy. So, I mean, we can support organizations that I think it's good to support them that do not ask for charitable status, like Greenpeace, for example. That's good. So in my book, I also have a chapter called Games Bureaucrats Play, and it shows the 2,172 access to information documents that I've received from four different government departments, all related to me, and it also reveals some of the games that they were playing, like cover your ass, sit on it, stupid cat tricks, peekaboo. It's really fun, and I think it's important that we make it fun, because most people, their eyes glaze over when you start talking about access to information. And this is a fun way to teach people how to fight back. So one of my games in the book is Peekaboo. And you know the CC list that's at the top of many emails, right? And in this case, let me see if I've got a picture of it. No. I don't. Anyway, it's a CC list, and you don't know any of the people on it. You get your access to information, you get thousands of pages, and it's got these CC lists at the top of the emails. And you go, who are these people? But they are actually the people who've requested to stay on top of the file. So they want to look at my file. And so I thought, well, how am I going to find out who these people are? So I Googled, and then I included some of them in the book just to show, you know, the level of people who were looking at my file. We've got Deputy Minister of Foreign Affairs. We had Cabinet and Parliamentary Affairs Division. We had the Director General of Communications Foreign Affairs, Gary Pringle, Head, Energy Secretariat Foreign Affairs. Stuart Wheeler, Director, DFAT, Cabinet Relations Division. And this is just a small sample of the people who are looking. I mean, this is crazy. Taxpayer money should not be wasted on interfering with an artist's climate change art show. This is bizarre. So I took my pledge, my plea out to the public, out to social media, and I said, I want you to join me. And remember, I was launching my book. I want you to join me in showing Harper that blacklisting and censoring citizens does not work, especially if they wield a paintbrush. And so over a short period, a short campaign, I raised almost $13,000. And that was from how many people? About 221 funders. And I was able to put this poster, Do Not Talk About Climate Change, up in Ottawa and Halifax and Calgary. And it was up in Calgary at the same time as the, coincidentally, as the Conservative Leadership Convention was there. So It was a lot of fun, got lots and lots of press. And then I took the show to Washington, D.C. And very strategically was able to get bus shelters that were positioned within view of the Capitol building. And this is just beautiful, beautiful. And David Suzuki and Sephora Berman came down for the press conference, And it was just wonderful, really remarkable. And so the show was larger than just that one piece. It was a No Keystone XL show where I had this piece and this one, Canada is a Dirty Old Man. That got lots of press. And the show, I called the show Oh No Canada. Nope. And this one, Oh Canada, What's Going Down? And Canada's carbon pollution is rising. Yes, with Fat Cat Canada there, responsible for the emissions. Now, who would have thought? I never thought that getting blacklisted by the Harper government would put me up there with Neil Young and Shad. But there you go. Press Progress named me as one of the five Canadian artists who rocked. And I'm in a textbook on censorship, right opposite Ai Weiwei. So kids in school, Canadian schools, sort of junior grades, they're discussing the issue of government censorship, and they're using my story as an example, as a case study, which is great. Is great. And they've got a really good question. So it's, do you think government has the right to censor an artist's work if it makes the government look bad? So that's what they're supposed to be discussing. And I think that that's really good. And I also think that this is a great quote from Michael Healy. Artists are telegenic, well-spoken, organized, and have access to media. Inflaming them should be avoided. There's no upside to pissing us off. So we can remember our power, right? And those who are not artistic can get artists to help them, because artists are great communicators. And we can really help make social change happen. CO2 keeps rising, but our leaders keep loafing. Will they take action before we're all toast? Together, we have the power to change governments, and that's why October 19th is so important. We've all got to get out there and vote for a greener Canada. So thanks, everyone.
So this is the kind of, you know, spirited protest, really, that we've and insight that we've been trying to bring to Royal Roads every summer as part of the Bateman Lectures. And, you know, Frankie has fully acquitted herself in riling us up and doing what I hope that we all do as teachers. I've always felt that what teachers do is they try to reveal things that are hidden, at the same time being open to revelation themselves. And I think this kind of analysis that she's presented in a very, you know, engaging and artistic way is very powerful, because it does reveal to us things that might be otherwise hidden, and to others who maybe aren't the kind of people who would come to a lecture tonight. So Frankie's willing to take some questions, and I'll let her moderate them.
Just
herself.
Before I take any questions, I've got to tell you one of my favorite sayings from Rick. Okay? And he came over to lunch at our place, and we're talking, and it's the first time that I've met him, and he's telling me about teaching students and activism. And he says what he tries to do is he tries to teach the students how to sprinkle pixie dust so that everybody can see what the problem is in society. And that is such a great idea, right? So here, I'm sprinkling a little pixie dust on the issue of, you know, censorship in Canada. And there's a lot of problems to go around and sprinkle pixie dust on. Canada has no shortage. But anyway, I really found that inspirational. I love that. Yes?
Shall we start? Yeah. So, hi, thank you so much. So I'm Renee, I met you earlier. So in our course, we're looking at the psychological dimensions of how we can communicate more effectively and do the pixie dust.
Right.
And we're diving into how complicated that actually really is. And my what I find so powerful about what you're doing is how disarming it is. And a lot of what we're looking at is how do we disarm ourselves and one another so that we can actually take in and kind of have permission to gain access to what is really going on, which is frankly very distressing and scary and can be overwhelming and paralyzing. And so I think we're all trying to find ways to disarm without being patronizing or sugarcoating or simplistic. And that's the balance that we're all finding. And so when I'm experiencing your work, all I want to do is just like, let's collaborate as much as possible with artists. And so my question for you is really kind of straightforward, like how do we do that more effectively? Because it's not actually happening at the level I think it needs to be happening.
Right. So a couple of thoughts as I'm listening to you. And I think one of them is we have to have honesty. And part of that honesty is really grappling with the fact that we have conflicting ideas, right? Like, you know, I got here on a bus that was powered, you know, by fossil fuels, and I'm riding in the ferry, and yet I want to take action on climate change. So when I'm constructing my stories, and I think storytelling is really huge, really, really helpful. When I'm doing the stories, I try to think of the arguments. I have this little person in my head who's arguing with me. And I try to address those arguments at the same time that I'm telling the story, because I know that those are doubts that are going to be in people's minds.
Right.
And if I don't address those doubts
explicitly,
then I'm going to lose them. So that's it. And I also think that it's important to collaborate with artists in such a way that the artists are involved in the whole thinking process. So it's not just a matter of the illustrating, it's like the whole creation process.
Do you think artists are wanting more of that?
Well,
like waiting to be, you know, invited into working more collaboratively?
I think that lots of artists would love to collaborate with, you know, scientists on climate change issues, right? But it's a matter of, you know, it's almost like the artist can be like the layperson who can take the complicated information and convey it in such a way that the ordinary person can understand it. So I'll give you an example. I was approached to do something for 350.org when it first came about, and it was about the rising CO2 emissions in the atmosphere. And for some reason, I thought of a toaster. I thought of the, you know, we're toasting the planet. So with the help of my husband, who's a programmer and a designer, we made a toaster, a CO2 toaster, which is available on your desktop. Like you can put it on your desktop, you can put it on your website. And what it does is it shows the Keeling curve, so the CO2 numbers going up from the very start to today's number, over 400. And that gets updated regularly. So anyway, that's an example. Okay, so how many times have you seen that Keeling curve, right? And most people, ordinary people, will just look at it and go, okay, that's a graph. Yeah, that looks bad. Yeah, it's up at 400. But what metaphors can we use to get people to understand what it really means? And so that's why we worked on the idea that we're toasting the planet. And it's a fun way. And then people are watching the numbers as they go up. And yes, so. And great job that you're working with students to do that. That's fantastic. I see a question way back there. Yes?
Hi, Frankie. Thank you so much. I'm a Green Party candidate for this area for a swimming slide. I mean, I just felt like I was like, this is just so perfect. This is the message. And even the Green Party values were in some of your slides there.
Thank you.
I thought, there's Elizabeth May being kept out of debates for this very reason, and that censorship happening right in front of our eyes. And that's this is the very reason why
yeah.
that she's not wanted in the debates. And I just think it's wonderful that you brought this up. Other question was, is your material available? Like, could we use this? Can we work collaboratively and put stuff like this? Like,
yes, and it's all online.
Fantastic.
All of my stories are online.
That's
and
great.
It's also in my book. Whoops. I don't have any I don't have any copies with me, but it's available online at Amazon.com, not .ca. You could you could order them from me. Yeah, and then we could arrange it.
Thank you so much, Frankie, and thanks to the organizers of this.
Thanks. Yes?
I'm just wondering, are artists across the country collaborating at all in like 70 days to try and get the message out from them and to the general public, especially to that 30% of people who are pretty hardcore conservative voters?
Are artists working on that?
Yeah, I just wonder, you've done this, you're promoting this through your website.
Right.
Do artists have anything going on, or do they plan on any kind of collective public events in different provinces? And doing like art shows or whatever in the next 2 months to highlight this, to try and bring more publicity to show the ludicrousy in the world?
Yeah, I don't know, but it sounds like a good idea. But there are obviously the organizations like Lead Now who are using, you know, artistic talent to and communicators to bring the message.
Just yeah. Some street theater always does well with the
yeah, something. Yeah, yeah. Okay. Yes.
I sort of get one of the feeling that part of the problem that we have in this country or with these issues is people live in different silos, and there are some people who may be sort of in the energy silo where these kind of things just aren't talked about, and they paste and cover the windows so they can't see out either.
Yeah. Yeah.
So they can just keep doing what they're doing.
Yeah. Well, I think that the divestment movement is really helping to change things. But I've got a funny story where, well, I'm going to make this into a story about going to see an investment advisor. Whoops, sorry. Going to see an investment advisor in 2012 and him telling me that you have to invest in the tar sands. And that it's the engine of Canada's economy. Mm-hmm. And that, you know, if you're not going to invest in the tar sands, I mean, basically, you should just invest in canned food and guns. Mm-hmm. This is a high-level investment advisor, Scotiabank.
Wow. Yeah, that's an art piece.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I'm working on it. Bill, yes.
Love to have your reaction to this. I was just having a glass of wine the other night with a really good friend of mine who's the publisher of a major left-leaning publication in the United States with a huge audience, and trying to coax him into coming up on a little sailboat trip up in Great Bear where talk about a lot of the issues. And he said, I just can't get my editors excited about why this has anything to do with us in the United States. You know, which kind of floored me. You know, I love seeing your work posted in Washington, but it really reminds me of what a disconnect there still is with the board.
I was really lucky. I had some organizations in Washington, like NRDC, NNWL, who helped organize that show, and you know, we brought David Suzuki down. I mean, that was amazing, right? Mm-hmm. It is really hard to get attention in the U.S., and but we should talk more about that. Yeah. Sounds like a great idea. Yes?
Thank you, Frankie, very much. Elections are the best opportunity to get out of our silo and talk to people who never really hear about these issues. And the only way that it happens is by going door to door. So I don't want to offend conservatives or liberals in the room, but going door to door for the Green or for the NDP is so critical. I'm urging everybody to give it a try.
Yeah.
Okay. Yes? Seems to me, and this gentleman with his silos made me think of this, that there are several that where the curve, graph curve, is similar. And I just wanted to hear your, if you wanted to comment, the population curve, the poverty curve, the scarcity of resources curve, all of these things, along with the worst crisis of all, which is, of course, climate change, but they're also closely related, it seems to me. Does it to you?
Yeah, I am. In some of my other talks, I've actually start with a slide of myself when I was 16, superimposed against the population graph, from and how the world's population will have tripled in my lifetime. And it's something that I never thought of when I was a teenager, and it just gives you an idea. Wow, I mean, how can the planet support three times as many people? You know, unless we are really careful about conservation and sustainability. So,
I was doing all the graphs and charts and things like that for a population expert back in the 40s, because he was my guardian during World War II, and you could see what was going to happen. And if you just walk the John Muir Trail, you know, in the Sierra, it's gone exponentially, the increase in people on it. But it's something that, like global warming, seems to be taboo, mostly, I think, possibly because of offending the religious right, stuff like that.
Right.
But it's been evident for that 60 years.
Right.
Very evident.
Yes?
I just heard yesterday on CBC that the oil, the tar sands in Alberta are approximately 2% of the total gross national product of Canada, which could be easily surpassed with solar in the matter of nothing. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's just the will that's necessary to do it.
Oh, that's good.
I did have a question, though. You mentioned that one of the reporters that originally was rather negative towards what you were doing did a freedom of information request, as well as yourselves. Did you ever get a chance to compare documents to see if were they redacted the same way? Because often I know government can be very confused and stuff gets released that, you know, accidentally or sloppily or...
That's so true. That's very true. I got my documents were a tiny bit different than hers, but essentially she got the same stuff because she piggybacked on my access request. In fact, Department of Foreign Affairs got in touch with me and said, someone else is requesting access to your file, and will you give them permission? And they wouldn't tell me who it was. And I went, well, I'm into openness and transparency. I guess I better say yes. So I said yes, and I didn't know who it was. And it turns out that it was Postmedia and Amy Chung. And she actually came to the opening of the show. So, you know, it was wonderful. It was wonderful to see that she was digging to get the truth.
One other factoid. I'm a commenter on the Kinder Morgan Clark pipeline, so I've been doing a lot of research in that area to be able to complete my documentation. And one of the things I looked at was the Exxon Valdez spill and Prince William Sound and where things are today. You said it cost $9.5 billion to clean up, of which Exxon paid $3.5. And by the way, they fought that in court over and over and over again to get it reduced and reduced and reduced.
Right.
Recent studies of Prince William Sound show that there's tremendous amounts of oil still left. There was a study in 2010, another one in 2012. There's massive amounts of oil still sitting at the bottom of Prince William Sound and still completely toxifying a lot of the water there. So it isn't cleaned up.
Yeah.
just looks nice.
Right. Mm-hmm. Right. One more question? Yes?
I'd love to hear you talk about how you've addressed some of the fear you might have had as you learned what was going on. Certainly it was referred to by the man who introduced you, sorry, I missed his name. And
Richard.
How you felt getting over it. I assume you've got over it.
Well, I mean, you never know. These politicians have long memories, right? Right. I never expected that I would get that they would retaliate in 2011 for something I wrote in 2008. So it is scary. However, it's the right thing to do. And there was no way that I was going to keep my mouth shut. And I needed to bolster my courage. And the way that I bolstered my courage was to call up a lot of smart people, like Richard, and ask their advice. And so one person that I spoke to down in the US, and I told him this, like what had happened, and he said, well, this is what you have to do. You have to run towards the controversy. Yeah. What? Run towards the controversy? That sounds really scary. But he was absolutely right. And that was absolutely what I had to do. And I really felt that I was safer to be out in the public, in the sunshine, just, you know, putting everything out there, being very transparent, than trying to solve this quietly, right? And also, and there was no way that I was going to take this to court, because the government would just say, well, we can't talk about it, it's before the courts. And it would bankrupt us, right? So this was the a way to fight back that was on grounds that I could fight, right? Because I'm a communicator, I can make the posters, I can do the stories, I can tell people, and I can raise awareness. And I really feel that most Canadians should be angry about this type of assault on free expression. I mean, we cannot have, it's just outrageous that the federal government would be meddling behind the scenes in a private citizen's business deal, which is essentially what my art show was, mm-hmm. right? And it's outrageous that they have been redacting stuff. It's outrageous that they've been redacting stuff under high-level security clauses that nobody can see under, except for half a dozen people in the Office of the Information Commissioner. So what they found out, what that Office of the Information Commissioner investigation found out, was that the government was misusing the security clauses. They were abusing them. And yet, it wasn't front page news. You know, well, I got a good story in the Ottawa Citizen, right? But people should be really outraged. Because effectively, what they did was they covered up the story for 4 years. And what is the story? The story is that I was censored because of my views on the oil sands. And that's not right. So that's why it's important that when we run into this censorship, that we actually don't keep our mouths shut and that we do speak up. And, you know, I know it's life-changing to do it, and it puts your job and your pension, unless in my case it didn't put my pension or my job at risk, but I did actually lose business from certain clients who didn't want to be associated with somebody who was going to be challenging the government. So anyway, this has been tremendous, and thank you all for your time and attention. I'm really honored to have been able to present.
So on behalf of the Master of Arts in Environmental Education Communication program, Franke, thank you very much. And for those of you who live on the West Shore, we've just, the Royal Roads University Faculty Association has just invited all of the West Shore candidates, including our Green candidate here, to join us at noon sometime in mid-September for an all-candidates meeting. It would be on campus, the community will be invited, but we thought we should be convening as a faculty association, the Green Party, Liberal, Tory, and NDP, to come to campus and talk to us about the issue. So we'll try to get the word out about that as well. But again, thank you all for coming. Thank you, Frankie. Yeah.